Now, it's time for Toker Talk Radio, the voice of the marijuana nation.
What are you people? On dope?
Where you can tope.
I inhale frequently.
Or you can talk.
I experimented with marijuana and didn't inhale.
Or you can toke and talk.
10 federal criminal penalties for possession of up to 1 ounce of marijuana.
While we talk about toke on Toker Talk Radio.
So, by the way, when it comes to pot, you know, if you're 40 years old, you live in a log cabin in Oregon, you got 12 giant pot plants in your backyard, have a ball.
Live from beautiful Portland, Oregon at Rolla J Studios.
Cannabis.
Plus your calls live at 971-533-7111.
They're walking on their pants with their cap on backwards, listening to Enema Man and Snoopy Snoopy Poop Dog.
What's to keep somebody from getting all potted up on weed and then getting behind the wheel?
Gateway theory doesn't work. It's a reality.
Holland, is it real? Don't tease me.
We're locking up people that take a couple of puffs of marijuana, and the next thing you know, they got 10 years.
And now, here's your host, the guru of ganja graphics, the sultan of sativa statistics, and the worst nightmare of a reefer mad prohibitionist. A polite, perspicacious, productive pothead with a propensity for PowerPoint. Radical Russ Belleville.
I got quiet all of a sudden. I don't know what to do. The Evermeter had a hiccup,
damn.
I think. Sorry about that. Welcome, it's Toker Talk Radio. You can toke, you can talk. It's Halloween. We're having a good time. I'm here with Dr. Brian the Red.
Libra is sick. Yes, we will investigate.
And we are having a little Halloween fun here. I am dressed up as the Pinhead Pothead. Or a pothead pinhead. I haven't decided which goes better. But I was just trying to cough a second ago, and I poked myself in the hand, covering my mouth. Got to remember, there's nails sticking out of my face.
Oh, you are so funny, yes.
Yeah. But welcome back to the show. And as we left the last segment, I thought it was a really good topic that we're discussing there, just this issue of race in the marijuana movement, because it has been for so long Lily White. Been a very, very white reform movement for marijuana. You know, until Madeline got on the board, like in 2008 or 9 for normal, it was all white dudes. You know, there was this.
It was actually before that. But
it was before that?
Yeah.
But it's been a pretty white movement, and that can lead to, and it's not like, I'm not trying to say that we're blind to the racism inherent in the marijuana prohibition, but you're going to be blind to certain parts of it. There's no way we can have a complete cognizance of what's going on unless you've actually experienced it, I think, in some ways. And it does tend to change your perspective. Like, you know, one of the things that frustrates me about the marijuana movement sometimes is the arguments about why we're using it or how good marijuana would be. You know, oh, if we legalize marijuana, it would help the ozone layer because, you know, and I make a lot of these arguments too, right? But, you know, if we did this with marijuana, something great would happen. And marijuana is so good for medicine. And marijuana is so much safer than alcohol. And marijuana doesn't get you addicted like cigarettes. And, you know, all these great things we can say about marijuana, right? But even if marijuana was more addictive than heroin, more dangerous to society than alcohol, more habitual than tobacco, more whack inducing than meth, whatever you want to say, even if marijuana was the worst drug on the planet, it wouldn't change the racial argument any, would it? All the other arguments we can make about marijuana and why to legalize it are arguments that can kind of fall apart. Like when we make the argument about the economics of it, right? We say, oh, we ought to legalize marijuana. We can tax and regulate it, right? We can raise revenue off of it. But what if that money doesn't show up? What if it gets taxed too high, like they're thinking in Washington or Colorado, and people in the black market keep using it? Or they'll say it the opposite direction, right? We can't afford to spend all this money on arresting, and we can't afford to spend all this money on jails. Well, what if the economy improves, and we can't afford it? Then should we? I worry about making the arguments being about why we use it or how much it costs or whatever, because at its heart, the very important argument at its heart is a civil rights argument. It's my body. We don't make arguments with regard to a woman's right to terminate a pregnancy with regards to, you know, whether she's good with, whether she likes kids, whether she doesn't like kids, whether she was planning to get pregnant, not planning to get pregnant, how many kids she wants. No, it's just her body. It's her right. You know, she could be an awful, terrible, promiscuous, irresponsible person who uses abortion as birth control and is coming in for her 12th one. Doesn't matter. It's her right. We don't have the right to judge as to why she might be doing that such a thing. And nobody has the right to judge as to why we're using the marijuana. So perhaps there's something to Dr. Hart's point in that it needs to be a civil rights issue, because when you look at the disproportionate policing of it, it really doesn't matter what it is that we're arresting this many black people for. Right? If it were the disproportionate arrests for jaywalking, it wouldn't matter, right? The racial issue of it is the problem that we need to look at solving, not necessarily the crime or alleged crime or supposed crime that's behind it. We need to look at what it is that turns that creates this racial injustice, that creates this disproportionate policing. I love the way that the Reverend Sanders at the drug policy conference said, it's just the mask. The war on drugs is just the mask for all these other things. So if we're going to be looking at marijuana prohibition and ending it, maybe we ought to be looking at what it's really covering up. And that is a way to police people, a way to break their constitutional rights, a way to get around constitutional protections, a way to keep your thumb on a certain neighborhood or a certain class of people. And why is it we feel the need to do that? Why do we feel that they need to be controlled, that they're going to go crazy on us, and we've got to lock them up? Those are some deep issues.
It's simply business. It's simply business. It's simply business, you know why they won't let us grow. It's simply business.
We'll be right back after these messages from our 420 friendly sponsors. Support these advertisers because their ad money goes straight to the Russ Belville Show. You're tuned into the Russ Belville Show, the voice of the marijuana nation.
It's simply business. It's simply business. It's simply business. You know why they won't let us grow. It's simply business. It's simply business. You know why they won't let us grow. It's simply business.
Tokers and Tokettes, Radical Russ here to introduce you to my friend Matt and all the staff at Lush LED Lighting. Growing plants indoors can be a rewarding hobby, but electricity bills can go through the roof. Then you have to cool down all those big hot lights. It can drive a grower insane. With Lush LED Lighting, you can solve many of these issues and double your rewards. If you thought LEDs were... meet the tech of today. Matt and his scientists have developed the perfect light for flowering plants with far less cost and heat. And the results? Let's just say I appear at a lot of events with the masters of indoor horticulture, and the harvests I saw from Lush LED Lighting were big, tight, sticky, and very effective. Check out LushLEDLighting.com right now and tell them Radical Russ sent you. Double your rewards and lower your expenses with Lush LED Lighting. I'm Radical Russ Belville, and I want to thank you for listening to 420 Radio. We couldn't survive without you and our sponsors, and I'd like you to check out one of our prime sponsors, the National Cannabis Coalition. I've been working with NCC since June of 2012, and I'm proud to be part of the team they have assembled. National Cannabis Coalition is building the partnerships with reformers, lawmakers, and industry we need to be successful. Visit the National Cannabis Coalition website at nationalcannabiscoalition.com or the easier-to-remember NCC420.com. That's where you'll get the exclusive first look at my radical rants, as well as informative articles from the nation's top cannabis pundits. Visit ncc420.com today, and if you have your phone handy, text Russ to 420-420 to support NCC and 420 Radio. It's a free text message that helps us help you end adult marijuana prohibition. Learn more at ncc420.com, and thanks for supporting independent marijuana legalization public radio.
Welcome back. 10 after on Halloween. Got some music from Random Orbits with Blowback. Just chilling out here with Dr. Brian the Red.
So discussing, I just checked up on the chat room to see what people were saying, and I got a lot of good points here for some people saying, let's see, this is one. It's a civil rights issue, but the group in this struggle is all marijuana consumers. No need to focus on minorities. Let's stick with what's working. Well, that's a good point. And Mason Tvert made the point, too, in those comment sections that the Amendment 64 campaign had a mass outreach to Latino voters, and that that outreach may have, you know, been part of what helped pass this law, because, you know, generally the support among Latinos is pretty low for legalization compared to black folks and white folks. And whether that ties to, you know, Latinos being more Catholic or, you know, more family oriented or whatever it might be, you know, traditional cultures, whatever it might be, we just tend to see that. And there were a number of great Spanish language commercials that came out on the Amendment 64 campaign. So I think Mason's right in that we're not ignoring the issue, but you have to go with what issue is going to win, and you have to go with the framing and the marketing that is going to get the thing passed. And I think that comment that said, you know, if you make this an issue just about race, about the disproportionate racial impact, it may make white folks even more apathetic than they may have already been to think about marijuana as a big deal issue. Because, you know, here's a thing to think about that makes marijuana kind of a tough reform issue sometimes. We keep saying over and over that there's 750,000 people that get arrested. 750,000 people. 0.75 million that get arrested for marijuana. But there's 17 million people every year using it. Or 17 million every month. 26 million every year. So, out of the 26 million people that are using it, there are 0.75 million arrests. That puts it about a 1 in 32 chance in a year. Kevin Sabet has a stat that he likes to point out. He likes to say that the chance is 12,000 joints. You have to smoke 12,000 joints before you get arrested, basically. And I don't know how he comes up with that number either, but the point I'm trying to make is that most cannabis consumers don't get arrested. Now, there's other ways that the civil right part hurts us, you know, living in the closet, you know, trying to keep everything hid, don't talk about what you do, you know, be secret, live a double life, all those kind of things. But for the most part, if you're, and especially if you're a white guy or a white woman, especially, who smokes pot, the chances that you're going to have any negative legal repercussions for that are pretty slim. So it's already an issue that's tough to get white folks all riled up about. Well, what's the big deal about smoking pot? A lot of people mistakenly think it's still like it's just a slap on the wrist kind of thing, that it's really no big deal. So there might be something to saying, look, if we made this primarily about the racial injustice and how black people are being put away on this, might it make white people even more apathetic toward the issue than they already are? I'd like to think better of us. I would like to think that as humans, we could look at the issue and go, hey, wait a minute, there's something really wrong here. when I can pull up, you know, 4 pages of black mugshots for every 1 page of white mugshots that I can find on any mugshot website, when I look up marijuana possession, there's definitely something wrong there. But can that be an issue that gets marijuana legalized? I don't know. It's an interesting debate, and I'd like to see, you know, more comments on that and more as this goes through. Because I know that with this hitting in the Nation magazine, and Dr. Carl Hart's got a pretty high profile, and Mason Tvert responding to him, I think we may have an interesting debate that is forming here online. So we'll take a look at that. We'll keep looking at that. as time goes on. I also wanted to get to some more information that I had in the Toker Talk radio bin here. Let's see if I can find this one. Which one is this one here? The pod one. There we go. And, I'm sorry. Let's just get back to tonight's show. Forgot to mention that we got Big Daddy Fink's Funky Roller Rink coming up tonight. Halloween episode. Fresh off of the Dropbox.
Yeah.
We got an hour of Halloween-themed funk from Big Daddy Fink. And yes. I'm sure you're going to love it. So check that out. It's going to be a good time tonight here on Halloween. You can put it on while all the ghouls and goblins are knocking on your door for the candy. So
be a funky, spooky, good time.
Funky, spooky, good time. Also, quick comment on that Maine situation, you know, the Portland, Maine situation. Man, if one of the discussions is going to be about whether race should be at the center, another discussion has got to be whether medical marijuana has outlived its usefulness in these campaigns. And I know people howl and scream and wail and gnash teeth when I start talking about that. But the medical marijuana strategy evolved in the early 90s when nationwide support for marijuana legalization was in the low 30s. You get one out of three people that support legalization, but you could get about two out of three that would support, you know, someone who had a medical need using this. So a lot of this was practicality in getting the medical marijuana issue done. But once it passed, once it took root, and people began to get onto these medical marijuana rolls and get their cards and get their what they felt was their rights, I think a lot of them forgot the rest of us that never got a chance to get on the bus. And it gets frustrating as all hell. And I know the argument is, well, you know, the sick and dying, they got to be first. We got to get the sick and dying off the battlefield first. And I have compassion for sick people as much as the next person, but I think we may have reached a position where that compassion is being turned against us, where in some situations they can say, well, here's a very restrictive medical bill, but you wouldn't want to let the cancer patients suffer, would you? And you end up with the kind of crap we got in Illinois. You end up with that situation in Washington, D.C., where they passed medical marijuana in 1998. They delay it for a dozen years. And when it finally does get running, you get one patient a day. One patient a day in probably one of the biggest populations of HIV/AIDS sufferers city-wise, as you could look at it in any city in America. And we can only get medical marijuana to one patient a day. And there's got to be some point where we do a benefit analysis on this and we ask ourselves, well, how much are we really helping as many patients as we could help if a lot of the patients can't get on the program because they don't have the particular condition or the money to afford the doctor to verify that condition? And then the patients that do qualify have to jump through hurdles that are so high and expenses that are so much and restrictions that are so onerous that they're not getting the best benefit they could get either. And both groups suffer because of the constant need to try to make sure that we separate people into groups. Those that are healthy enough to put in a cage, those that are sick enough to protect. And this division, this divide and conquer strategy, has seemed to have created an industry where certain members, certain factions of that industry, are for the status quo. They want to keep it that way. They want to keep the hurdles high for patients. They want to keep the prices high for patients. They want to keep the competition out. They vote against legalization. They take marijuana money and fund campaigns against legalization. And what would help patients more than legalization? Than ending this insane separation between healthy and sick and allowing even a healthy person to have as much access to weed as we think the sickest person needs. If everybody has open access to weed, then patients don't have to worry about it. And they don't have to jump through these hoops that are meant to try to keep us separate. Let's band together. And in the next few states, let's fight for legalization right out.
Wait, I know what that sound means.
Yep. It's 420 here in the Pacific time zone.
Well, it's always 420 somewhere.
And it's Halloween 420, so we gotta take some monster hash.
Get to the endocannabinoid system functioning now.
Oh, have you ever met that funny reefer man? A reefer man. Have you ever met that funny reefer man? A reefer man. If he said he swam to China, he would sell you South Carolina. Then you know you're talking to that reefer man.
The law offices of Omar Figueroa would like to remind you to stand up for your rights. Please do not give up your precious liberties. There's nothing wrong with standing up for our constitutional rights, and in fact, it's the only way to honor the Constitution that recognizes our natural rights. Treat law enforcement with respect, and respect the Constitution by standing up for your rights. If you are detained or arrested, stand up for your rights by repeating, I respectfully invoke all my legal and constitutional rights. I do not consent to any search and seizure, I want to remain silent, and I want to speak to my attorney, Omar Figueroa. Omar Figueroa has more than a decade of experience in federal and California courts and graduated from Yale University, Stanford Law School, and Trial Lawyers College. Please contact the law offices of Omar Figueroa at 415-489-0420 or 707-829-0215 or on the web at www.omarfigueroa.com. Adam Hand of Handmade Apparel produces quality custom designs for t-shirts, hats, and other apparel. Handmade Apparel is the official design shop for 420 Radio, The Russ Belville Show, Ganja John, and Cascadia Concentrates, among many clients who rely on Adam Hand for everything from short-run custom projects to full-run clothing lines. Adam's meticulous designs are individually crafted and screened in vibrant high-definition color. Visit handmadeapparel.biz to browse the selection of handmade gear or to get a personal quote for your own designs. Handmade Apparel, a proud supporter of 420radio.org. Got a comment, question, complaint, or request for 420radio.org? Visit our contact page at 420radio.org/contact today. Not a pound, but working on it. Welcome back, Toker Talk Radio here on the last day of October, Halloween. Hope you have a good Halloween tonight. And while you're listening, while you're having that Halloween, listen to Big Daddy Fink's Funky Roller Rink. You have yourself a funky good time. Coming up next at the 5 o'clock hour, we have got Jorge Cervantes TV. Lots of great grow information. At 6 and 7, replays of these 2 hours, and then at 8, again, Big Daddy Fink's Funky Roller Rink. Now, looking out on CNN.com, I see our good buddy Kevin Sabet has written another op-ed, which means that's time.
Marijuana is an addictive drug, which produces in its users insanity, criminality, and death. Marijuana is the most violence-causing drug in the history of mankind. If the hideous monster Frankenstein came face-to-face with the monster of marijuana, he dropped it from fright.
You know, it's not easy countering 7 decades of propaganda in a 2-hour show, but let's try. It's time for the Russ Belville Show's Reefer Madness Debunked.
All right, in our latest Reefer Madness here, we have a CNN opinion piece written by Kevin Sabet that says, legalized pot would mean more addiction. More addiction. addiction. So let's dig into here and see what Kevin Sibet has to say. He starts by saying the war on drugs has failed is a mantra often heard in policy and media circles these days. But not only is the phrase outdated, the 1980s called, they want their slogan back. It is far too simplistic to describe both current drug policy and its outcomes. So he starts by talking about how the latest incarnation says that since cannabis and heroin prices have fallen while their purity has increased, efforts to curb drug use and its supply are doomed to failure. But Kevin says, hold on just a moment. Globally, drug use has been stable over the past decade. But in the U.S. alone, there has been a 40% drop in cocaine use since 2006 and a 68% decrease in workplace positive cocaine tests. Overall, in the U.S., all drug use has fallen by about 30% since 1979. Let me explain to you how Kevin Sibet plays these little games. Imagine a roller coaster, okay? Start that roller coaster. You're going up. I'm going up. You're on this big steep incline. Now, if I stop that roller coaster at that very moment that you're on that big steep incline, and I asked you, which direction does this roller coaster go? You'd say up. But wait, just a little bit longer. Goes all the way to the top, goes all the way to the top, it gets all the way to the top, it gets right at the top there. And if I stopped it there and I asked you which direction was this roller coaster going, you'd say forward. And then it crests the hill and goes whoosh, and you're rushing down the hill. And if I asked you then which way the roller coaster is going, you'd say it's going downhill, it's going downhill real freaking fast. And then maybe it comes up to a little uphill, right? But if I asked you about this hill, was this hill as big as the hill that you started on, the very first hill at the roller coaster? No, this one's not quite as big. What I'm painting here for you is the fact that Kevin Sibet likes to look at the numbers that rise and fall and rise and fall for this drug, that drug, or the other drug, and uses them to just say that this particular drug has gotten bad. Cocaine has dropped 40% since 2006. How much did it go up before 2006? All drug use has dropped since 1979. Yeah, because if you throw marijuana in there, marijuana was used in a great deal in 1979. It was the number one time that we saw the greatest amount of marijuana use. You could also say overall drug use is way up since 1992 because marijuana use was at its lowest point at that point. So he's playing this little statistical game where you pick the valley and say, okay, look how much it's gone up since then. Or you pick the peak and say, oh my God, look how much it's gone down since then. He also comes up and says, we can't ignore that the world's top supplier of cocaine, Colombia, has greatly improved its security system. It's managed to reduce the amount of land dedicated to coca growing by nearly two-thirds from 2000 to 2010. In one small little sentence, Kevin Sibet is able to just gloss over the fact that what we are doing is fumigating the land of poor farmers who the only crop they can grow to make enough money to get by in their world is coca. And so we're destroying families, we're destroying their lives, we're impoverishing them, we're ruining their land, we're causing all sorts of terrible health effects to them because of these pesticides that are floating around in the air on these people. And cocaine production moved. He said, he even goes on himself, this is Kevin Sibet saying, potential production of cocaine has also fallen more than 60%, though in places without security enhancements, namely Bolivia and Peru, cocaine production has picked up. Without such security enhancements. The security enhancements would be, you know, more guns, more soldiers, more cops, more fumigation of crops. See, the problem, according to Kevin Sibet, is that we just haven't done it to enough of the countries yet. We did it to Colombia, but now we need to go do it to Peru and Bolivia, and Ecuador, and all the other countries. It's like squeezing a balloon. You squeeze one end of the balloon, and all the air rushes to the other end of the balloon. If we wipe it out in Colombia, they'll start making it in Ecuador. We wipe it out there, they'll make it in Bolivia, they'll make it the next country. Even if we were able to wipe it out in all those countries, someone somewhere would find a way to grow it, and it would just get more expensive. And there'd be more war fought over it, and there'd be more bloodshed. Another thing that he likes to point out here is that the prescription drugs, he says, we know from our experience with currently legal drugs, prescription drugs, the leading cause of accidental deaths in America, alcohol and tobacco, that legality means commercialization, normalization, and wider access and availability that lead to more use and addiction. Okay, hold on, stop. Prescription drugs are highly physiologically addictive, some of them. Alcohol is highly physiologically addictive, and so is tobacco. Cannabis has the lowest dependency rate of anything you just listed. And since cannabis can be a replacement for tobacco, a replacement for alcohol, and a replacement for some prescription drugs, using cannabis is overall harm reduction. Kevin, you can't come in here and talk to us about how much harm we have from the legal drugs and then deny us something that would replace them. That makes no logical sense. If they're as harmful as you're saying they are, you should be the first person on board for getting marijuana legalized so people can stop taking that shit and start taking some marijuana instead. We'll get to some more of this debunking, but I just had to stop for a second because Captain Cannabis showed up. Is that who you are, Captain Cannabis?
I'm the little bit of a activist that exists inside of all tokers.
Captain Cannabis it is. All right. Stick around, folks. We got more to talk about. 32 after the hour.
We'll be right back after these messages from our 420 friendly sponsors. Support these advertisers because their ad money goes straight to the Russ Belville Show. You're tuned into the Russ Belville Show, the voice of the marijuana nation.
Cast your eyes up to the skies. What is it to live and die?
No Herb Thrasher from the Herb Thrasher Flower Hour. Now get ready for Herb Age Designs for the proud cannabis consumer. Herb Age Designs, lifestyle gear for the 420 friendly. Herb Age Designs, home of the famous lighter leash. Herb Age Designs, get your Herb Age t-shirts and hoodies and show your pride. Herb Age Designs, we've got frisbee golf discs and durable hemp gear. Herb Age Designs. We've got shot glasses, drinking glasses, coffee mugs, and beer cozies. Check us out on Facebook and online at herbagedesigns.com. And follow Herb Age and Herb Thrasher on Twitter. We'll see you at this year's Hemp Fest. Crank it up!
Даня Данько. Я редактор журнала High Times. Отвечаю за отдел культивации, или проще говоря, выращивания. Приглашаем вас в Амстердам с 24 по 28 ноября, чтобы посетить ежегодный турнир Cannabis Cup, уже 26 по счету. Там мы сравним множество видов марихуаны и гашиша из смежных кофешопов. Еще у нас там выставка товаров, семинары по выращиванию, ночные концерты и вручение премии за лучшие в мире сорта марихуаны. Хотите получить 10% скидку со стоимости билета? Используйте промокод Данько на сайте cannabiscup.com. Ждем вас!
Drugs. This is your brain on drugs.
questions.
Damage.
We check is we live. We be high in the fucking building. House, coast, all that, nigga.
Damage.
Welcome back, everybody. 35 after the hour here at Toker Talk Radio.
Say what?
We're continuing the debunk of Kevin Sabet, who is getting hit from all angles these days. It's wonderful. I think most of the mainstream is on to him. It's pretty funny seeing some of the responses these days. And I'm going to get back to some of his points, such as they are, because he comes on to this whole normalization and wider access and availability that lead to more use and addiction. Well, here's what I think about that. This whole idea that there'll be more people smoking marijuana, and that in and of itself is a bad thing, needs to be attacked. We need to recognize that with legalization, there will be some things that will happen. And one of them is more people will smoke marijuana. And for a long time, we've backed off of that or tried to fight it when our opponents would say things.
Everyone knows if we legalize that more people will use it. There'll be more use. There'll be more access. There'll be more use. The prices will be lower and more people will use. And we've fought that.
Well, not necessarily, or maybe there'll be a slight uptick or whatever. I think we need to start getting to the point where we just own up to it and promote it. Part of this is because for the years that marijuana reformers has been working on this issue, there's been pains taken by some, you know, who work especially in Washington, D.C. with the mainstream to make sure that they're not pro-pot, they're anti-prohibition. And that's, you know, that's a reasonable, you know, strategy. It's a reasonable way to think for some folks. But I think now that we have the majority on our side, we don't need to fear so much being pro-pot. I think we're getting to a point now where we might start having to defuse some of our opponents' talking points by being pro-pot. When they say use will go up, we need to say good. Good. More people will use marijuana instead of overdosing on prescription drugs. Good. Use will go up. More people will be using marijuana instead of binge drinking and getting behind the wheel. Well, good, good, good. Oh, use will go up instead of people popping 6 to 8 Advils a day to control their minor aches and pains. Well, gee, that sounds good to me. That needs to be the answer to use may go up. Don't let them play the statistic of use without tying it to the statistics of harm. It doesn't matter whether use goes up. There never seems to be any campaigns out there to get fewer people to drink alcohol. Mm-hmm. I don't ever hear that. Don't drink. You're better off if you don't ever drink. Paid for by the ad council. Right? We never hear that. We never get that ad.
Never.
Now, we get the campaigns of drink responsibly. You know, don't drink and drive.
Mm-hmm.
Never is there a campaign that says
you just don't drink. Yeah, but always, don't smoke marijuana. No, because then you're a criminal. And then we can terrorize you and your family and your friends and make your life hell. So you shouldn't smoke marijuana.
It's just kind of implied that, you know, alcohol use is okay. Mm-hmm. So whether you're using it or more people are using it, it doesn't matter because alcohol use is okay. What matters if more people are getting in drunk driving wrecks? What matters if more people are alcohol overdosing? That's the attitude that we need to start having toward marijuana. It doesn't matter if more people are using it. Are more people getting hurt?
It's a harm factor, you know.
And we've seen, the other statistic that we've seen is that alcohol and marijuana have seemed to have been complementary in the medical marijuana states. They've found declines in teen drinking, in drunk driving issues. They're seeing that a lot of people, the beverage sales, alcoholic beverage sales go down. And I can just tell you anecdotally from doing 30, 40 different events in the cannabis community for however many years I've been doing them, that, first of all, most of them don't have alcohol on site. And second, the ones that do, or that have their parties in bars or whatever, bars either do just as well or worse than they normally do. Like, if there's like a, if there's a bar at like a hemp fest or an outdoor gig, an event, I never see those bartenders overworked. You know what I mean?
Yeah, there's no huge lines like there are for other things.
There's people getting a beer. There's people drinking some wine. But not, you know, there's not a emphasis on it.
The food trucks got hit harder than the bar.
There did. You go. That's what gets hit is the food trucks, right?
I remember specifically seeing the lines for the food trucks and then the lines for the bar at the San Francisco Cup last year.
Yeah, exactly. And this, of course, you know, this is something that brings up and this is something we got to think about too, to kind of just segue into a different angle of this discussion. There's been some talk, I've been behind some of it, about the whole Marijuana is Safer campaign. And while we were at the drug policy conference, Graham Boyd, who used to be with ACLU, but now he is just counsel to Peter Lewis. That's Graham Boyd's gig is giving advice to a billionaire. That's his actual job description. Counsel to Peter Lewis. He gives advice to a billionaire. And he was on a panel that Rob Campia from MPP was also on and made a point of saying we would prefer, you know, the Marijuana Safer campaign is all great, but when you find a politician who has alcohol in his background, like a mayor who owned brew pubs or whatever, don't attack them over that. Don't attack them personally over their involvement with alcohol, because then it makes it harder for us to work with them in the future. And that leads a little to me, you know, when I was complaining about the billboard we had in Portland, which was, why are we trying to piss off alcohol drinkers?
Yeah.
You know, yes, marijuana is safer than alcohol, but and here's the thing, is like there's that commercial, and we play it on here every now and then, the commercial they wanted to run, where they compared, you know, no hangovers, no violence, mm-hmm. you know, right?
Yeah.
But every before shot of an alcohol drinker was a negative shot of alcohol consumption. It's like the guy's beer belly.
Yeah.
Right? And the angry husband who's about to beat his wife. Yeah. And then the hungover woman, right? Mm-hmm. And it just seemed to me like, you know, we don't need to necessarily disparage the drinkers of alcohol. Or the users of any other drug, for that matter, but that's a whole nother discussion. But we don't need to disparage the users of alcohol. We can say marijuana's safe without saying, and beer drinkers have beer bellies. Right? You know, we don't have to make it like that. Because for the most part, during this fight for marijuana legalization, the major alcohol industries have kind of stayed on the sidelines. Yeah, I know, they funded Partnership for a Drug-Free America back in the day, but for the most part, big alcohol has kind of been sitting on the sidelines watching what's going on with this, and they haven't really lobbied hard. And there's also, and this was a good point that Rob Campy made, is that the alcohol industry is multi-layered. There is the brewers, there are the distributors, and then there are the retailers and wholesalers, right? So you got the people that make the beer, the people that ship the beer, and the people that sell the beer. And when it comes to how they might feel about marijuana legalization, they're not monolithic. Each layer may have a different response to it. For example, the distributors could get on board with marijuana legalization if, when we wrote the legalization law, we said it must be distributed in a manner similar to alcohol, or, you know, cut them in. Have them also be a part of the distribution of marijuana. Maybe you could get distributors on that. If marijuana were to be sold in stores that also sell liquor, that might get the liquor retailers on board. Maybe it'd be just the brewers, you know, the ones that actually make the profit off of the beer itself, that might have a problem with legalization, knowing that it's a complementary good. But I know in my experience, just, you know, for all the pot smokers I know and all the pot smoking events I know, I don't see people drinking that much. And that's just something that's, we're going to have to start promoting, is that the rising levels of marijuana use are a good thing. The other thing we have to protect about is they're going to be worried about the rising levels of marijuana use amongst teens. Will that go up? Well, we don't know. What we do know is in Colorado, where they got medical marijuana, and they all, and you know, how much they complain about, you know, oh, there's more medical marijuana in Denver than Starbucks. You know, all the complaints we hear about it. Teen use in Colorado is actually lower than the national average. That's according to the Youth Risk Behavior Survey, most recent one. So regular marijuana use by teens in Colorado is actually lower than the national average, despite being in one of the most medical states there is. Now, we don't know if this will go up after legalization, but I think we ought to start preparing for it. I wouldn't be surprised to see teen use go up after legalization. And that's what our opponents will hit us with. See, you legalized and more kids used. Ah. And so we got to learn how to deflect that. And part of deflecting that is to tie it to other harms. I want to see what happens to teen drinking rates. I want to see what happens to teen drunk driving deaths. I want to see what happens to teen dropout rates. I want to see all other stats here. So that when they come back and say, oh, marijuana use has gone up, we can say, yeah, but fewer kids are dying from binge drinking and drunk driving. Because there is a large group of parents out there, I talk to them all the time, who have a basic attitude of, well, I don't want my kids smoking pot or drinking, but if I had a choice, they'd pick the pot. There's a lot of parents like that. They don't want them doing either, but if they had a choice, they'd rather that they were smoking pot. Another angle to consider, and this was done to perfection in MPP's commercial in Colorado, where the girl is typing, I feel safer around marijuana users. That's something that resonates with every mom and dad who has a daughter who's worried about her going to some alcohol party and getting too drunk and getting some sort of date rape situation going on. Some sort of assault that just doesn't seem to happen with marijuana. Not to say that she might not get some. Marijuana does make you want to get freaky, but you know what I'm saying? At least it'll be consensual with marijuana. That's what I'm trying to say anyway. That's an angle that we can point out, is that crowds of marijuana users are far safer to be around. A lot of angles on this, and that's why we're here. That's why we discuss this every day. We get together, kind of strategize and theorize and build our movement together, build our talking points, run them by each other. We're going to win this. We are winning this. Even in your state, sooner than you expect, trust me on this one. We're going to take a break. When we come back, we'll wind up the show. Have yourself a great Halloween listening to 420 Radio.
We'll be right back after these messages from our 420 friendly sponsors. Support these advertisers because their ad money goes straight to the Russ Belville Show. You're tuned into the Russ Belville Show, the voice of the marijuana nation.
I'm Sub Cool from Team Green Avenger. At TGAGenetics.com, we are working on the leading edge of medical strains. Our strains are rigorously tested for THC, CBD, THCV, and other critical cannabinoids. Know your grow. Check out our genetic diversity at TGAGenetics.com, the home of Jelly Bean, Jack the Ripper, Vortex, and other award-winning cannabis strains.
Big Daddy thinks.
Spongy, roll a ring.
Everybody loves the sunshine.
marijuana and alcohol are the two most popular recreational drugs in America. Marijuana smoking is non-toxic, relatively safe, and has a low risk of dependence. Alcohol drinking is potentially fatal, dangerous to society, and is quite addictive. Marijuana is safer, so why are we driving people to drink? That's the question of the new book, Marijuana is Safer, So Why Are We Driving People to Drink? By Paul Armentano, Mason Tvert, and Steve Fox. Visit Amazon.com or ChelseaGreen.com today to order your copy of Marijuana is Safer, or visit MarijuanaIsSafer.com.
Welcome back, everybody. 51 after the hour on Halloween here at Rolla J Studios in beautiful Portland, Oregon. Thanks for being here. We got Captain Marijuana. Captain Normal? I'm not sure.
No, I like I said, I'm a representative of the little activist that's inside of every toker.
Okay. So that's a pretty long name, though.
Yeah, well, you know.
You might have to work on that.
It's not a name. It's a title.
It's a way of life, man.
Yeah.
Hey, I want to give a big shout out to one of our listeners who is making my life very, very cool. And that is the Canna Guru. Let me see if I got his email up here. Because, as you know, I got back from the Drug Policy Reform Conference in Denver. And I traveled with a lot of crap this time and had a bunch of stuff in my pockets and some pillows and stuff that I forgot at the TSA.
Yes.
I forgot all my stuff. I had two pillows. I got the little silver neck pillow and the silver back pillow because, you know, you got to sit in a little torture device for 2 hours. Hmm. And then I had my my card case, my little card wallet. It's got my stickers and my business cards. And it also had my grinder card, papers,
yep,
and my medical marijuana card. Not just my medical marijuana card, all the cards I've ever had.
Yep.
Every card I've ever had since I started in here. So that was in there. So that bummed me out because getting a replacement's $100. And then also my little wooden stash box. Got this little wooden stash box with a sliding lid that I got at the Desert Botanical Gardens in Scottsdale, Arizona. It's about 1 inch wide by 3/4 inch deep by about 3 inches long. It'll fit a one hitter and some weed, right? And it still had some weed in it because it's Colorado.
Yep.
Right? I can possess that and I can possess it when I get home. So didn't matter. So anyway, I tweeted this out the other day. You know, it's like, oh, this sucks. I forgot all my stuff. Blah, blah, stupid me, blah, blah, blah. And so one of our listeners, the guru, got in touch with me. He said, hey, dude, I'm flying into DIA on Thursday. I'll stop by the Lost and Found and pick up your stuff and mail it to you.
Yeah,
so I called Denver International Airport and got in touch with a nice lady named Francine there at Lost and Found. He said, yes, we have your stuff. Mm-hmm. We have the silver pillows. We have the little box. We have the thing. It's number so-and-so, and yes. And so I gave permission. I said, yeah, let this guy pick it up for me. You have my permission, all that kind of stuff. I described exactly what it was, exactly who he was to come pick it up, right? So here's the note I just got from the guru. Got your gear and mailed it out.
Yeah, buddy.
Should be there Saturday or Monday. Looks like Denver PD had a look at your stash box. You'll see.
Probably had an evidence tag on it.
I don't know. Or if they broke it. I hope they didn't break it.
Because
it's just one of the things, a little wooden box.
You slide just out. Push the yeah, lid to but slide it. You know, if you're not savvy.
They might have broken open to try to get into it. I don't know.
Oh, dummies.
But what I don't know is, what?
Oh, maybe it's got dog teeth on it.
Well, here's what I want to know is why is Denver PD looking at it?
Yeah.
It's a closed box, okay? It's a closed box with no visible lid. It's like one of them nice ones where they slide shut, and like you have to know that it's a lid.
It's out of public view. Right?
But it did have a glass one-hitter in it, so if you shook it, it would feel empty, and it would make a rattly noise, right? Mm-hmm. But just examining it, there's nothing indicative about it that would indicate that it has anything illegal in it. Because marijuana is not illegal. And the size of the damn thing, it would not be humanly possible to be to put more than an ounce in it. So why is Denver PD having an extra close look at my stash box that has nothing in it that is illegal? I can't wait to get this back and see what Denver PD might have done.
Yes, then we can do a little investigation of our own.
Exactly. So, there we'll see. We shall see if my Fourth, Fifth Amendment rights have been violated, and if so, maybe I will file a complaint with the Denver PD.
Grievance and such.
That will be an interesting little grievance. So what are you doing for Halloween tonight, do you know?
Just spreading the good word of cannabis.
That's right. Well, I think there's some sort of party at New Amsterdam with Ganja John's, so maybe we'll head over to Ganja John's place.
That sounds acceptable.
Because now that I got all this stuff on, I don't, you know, I feel like I got to do something.
You have to touch up the back, though.
Oh, yeah, I never did get to the back, but, you know, on camera, I figured it wouldn't matter. Maybe Captain Cannabis can help me with that here.
Indeed.
Oh, also, don't want to forget that coming up tomorrow, we've got a great show with two different guests. We got two guests on tomorrow's show.
Bonus guest.
At 3:30, we've got Anthony Johnson from New Approach, Oregon.
Awesome.
And we're going to talk to him about their filing, you know, for legalization and how that effort is going. And then at 3:45... we have got Brandon and Eric Chambers, the directors and producers of Cheech and Chong's animated movie.
Oh, excellent. I remember last year when we got an exclusive sneak preview of the soundtrack.
That's right. They're going to be here because it's debuting on the independent film channel, IFC, is going to be showing Cheech and Chong's animated movie. They wanted to come on and talk a little bit about it and tell us what's happened since that movie first debuted. And
well, we'll be happy to accommodate them here at 420 Radio.
And perhaps we'd get ourselves a free copy.
That would be excellent.
That would be
or
most
maybe we
excellent.
Could just agree to a screening.
Something like that. That would be fantastic. So that's coming up on Friday's show. Also coming up on Friday, Herb Thrasher Flower,
yes.
8 o'clock Pacific. Also on Friday, 5 o'clock Pacific, the replay of Big Daddy Fink's Funky Roller Rink, the Halloween episode. So if you can't stay up late tonight on the East Coast for that, stay up just a little bit till 8 o'clock East Coast time tomorrow for the replay of the Funky Roller Rink. And coming up this weekend, we've got the Libra Lounge with Lively Libra and Mr. Libra. And our new show on Sundays at 2, I think, is Weejucated.
Weejucated.
Weejucated coming to us from Arizona, I believe, is where that show is from.
Excellent. It's good to see so many of our fine cannabis activists out there spreading the good word.
That's right. And if you've got the hankering to get your message out to the rest of the cannabis community or know somebody who's got a great show, let us know here at 420 Radio. We're available on the TuneIn.com radio network as well as Ustream, iTunes, and YouTube for our replay videos. And speaking of those replay videos, I'm putting up the videos from the Drug Policy Alliance conference. I've also translated them to MP3 for a podcast. I uploaded about 10 of them last night. I'll do another 10 or so today. And so if you subscribe to the 420 Radio news feed, you'll get MP3s from all the presentations and speeches that I was able to cover over the last weekend of the Drug Policy Conference. That's all the time we got here for today. I hope you have a happy Halloween. Make sure to keep the medicated stuff separate.
Indeed.
For Brian the Red, I'm Radical Russ, the Pothead Pinhead. And until next time,
take care of each other, Tokers.
This is the Russ Belville Show. The Russ Belville Show is blogging and podcasting daily at RadicalRuss.com. You take a seed, you plant it, you grow it, you